Romans 15 and 13 states, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." We're coming to you today with some songs of encouragement, some songs of hope. We understand that we're living in troubling times, and there can be a sense of unrest in our lives and our hearts. But today, church and family around the world, we have hope in Jesus Christ. The next few songs that we're going to sing state simply that, we have hope in Jesus Christ. We invite you to join us as we sing.
For Jesus.
the sweetest frame, but I'll wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. Put our hope and our trust in you. God, no matter what life brings us, you are a sure foundation. And we place our life in your hands. For Father, you are the King over all things. You're the ruler over all. And you're the King of our hearts. So God, today we just stop from what is going on around us and we worship you. God, we worship you in spirit and in truth, knowing that you hold us in the palm of your hands and you're a good Father. So let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my soul. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my soul. Let's sing it. You are good. Situation by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, and whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. For when the night is holding on to me, God is holding on. And when the night is holding on to me, you're still holding on. And when I don't
if you had a title for today's message, it would be When God Turns Out the Lights. And for several of us, it seems like today that in the last couple of weeks, and maybe it started in China last year and it's gone through Italy and Europe and now in the United States, it seems as if God has literally turned out the lights. Where is God in all of this? Where is hope in all of this? Where's the church? It seems like that the churches are having to close down. So where is the church? The church is right in the mirror. It's me and you. The church is you and I being the ones, the voices of hope to a hopeless world, being the light to those who feel like they're in darkness, being the voice of calm in the midst of all of the calamity that's around us, to be the peace speaker when somebody just got the last loaf of bread in the grocery store, to be the person of encouragement to the cashier who has been strained and stressed because the line never stops and she hasn't gotten much of a heat. Or she hasn't gotten much of a break. We are the church. We are the hands of hope and of peace today. But in Jeremiah chapter 29, I want you to just turn there because we want to just look at it. It says in the text, verse 1, that this is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the priest. The prophets and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. And this was after King Jehoiakim, the queen mother, and the court officials and the leaders of Judah and Jerusalem, the skilled workers and the artisans had gone into exile from Jerusalem. He entrusted the letter to Elisha, son of Shaphan, and Jeremiah, son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent to King Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. And it said, "This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all of those that I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Now, as we stop right there for just a moment, it gives us an idea, and we see in this context of Scripture exactly where they're at. They're in exile. They are in a foreign land. They're in a place that they despise, and they are similarly in a hopeless situation. They're in a place that they never saw themselves. They're in a land that they never saw themselves. These were the people of God, and all of a sudden they find themselves in exile and not among the people of God and not in the land that God had given them. They were in a hopeless situation. Now, when we define the word hope, I want you to understand that hope gets us through a lot of situations. Hope can get us through the darkest days. Hope can get us to keep going when we feel like quitting. Hope can cause people and a country to rise up in the darkest of time. Hope is defined as to cherish a desire with anticipation, to want something to happen or to be true. But hopelessness is not an anticipation of something happening. Hopelessness is not something that anticipating that something's going to happen or to be true. Rather, hopelessness is not where life rules. Hopelessness is where despair rules. You may have a good day. Some people that are in hopeless situations and they find themselves in a hopeless state, they may have a good day, but hopelessness tells them that it won't last. And people who are hopeless and walking around hopeless, it's almost like the 4th of July when they shoot off the fireworks. They brighten up the sky for a moment, but then it goes dark again and the hopelessness settles back in. It's like they're drowning in a sea called hopelessness while surrounded by a land called happiness, and they can never get to shore. Oftentimes, people who are in hopeless situations, they find themselves going to different avenues and different defense mechanisms in an attempt to just get the pain to stop. I just want the pain to stop. But when they get to the point of jumping, last week we were going over to this very long bridge, and there was this motorcyclist that had pulled off to the side. And in fact, I went down the bridge, and he was on the opposite side, and I turned back around and to see if just to see what was going on. And another reason is a cop had gone on the opposite direction. I just want to see if maybe this was just the status quo, if people could just stop on the side of the road and look at, over a bridge and leave their legs hanging, dangling on the other side of a very, very high bridge. But as I rode by, the cop hadn't stopped. And maybe it's just something that happens all the time. But I kept thinking it to this thought when I was looking at it. When you get to the point of jumping, you've become hopeless. When you get to the point of looking at, you know, the anticipated end of the choice that you're about to make is going to end in disaster and death, possibly for yourself, you have reached the point of hopelessness. In fact, many would jump, and when they get to the point of hopelessness, many would jump, but they're just too scared. They're tired of living, but yet they're also scared of dying. They're drowning. They're bobbing up and down in the sea of hopelessness, constantly living up under a cloud. Maybe you at this point, especially in the last couple of weeks, as we've noticed the coronavirus do something to our nation, to our stock market, has all of a sudden plunged to the lowest level since 2008. Many of us on our 401ks, if we have anything, or in retirement or whatever, we've watched it vanish in the matter of moments. Some people have gone from being hopeful about retirement to a hopeless state of retirement. What am I going to do? I'm too old to work. I'm too old to do anything. And yet everything has changed in a matter of moments. Financial hopelessness says that we'll never be able to get out of debt. A relational hopelessness says that they're never going to change. Maybe you're in a career hopelessness that says you'll be stuck in a job that you hate going to. Singles who feel hopeless say they'll never find someone for them. The feeling of being stuck where you are and never having a way out is what hopelessness feels like. And right here in Jeremiah chapter 29, this was a hopeless people in a hopeless situation. God's people were feeling hopeless day after day and year after year. And maybe right now we're living in unprecedented times and uncharted waters, and you may feel hopeless. Hopelessness may feel like I'm never going to get out of this house. Hopelessness may feel like I'm never going to have enough food. I'm so scared. I don't know whether to hoard or whether to buy. I don't know whether to wait or maybe this is just the media hyping this up. Hopelessness takes away the security. But can I tell you, as people of God, we have the ability to find our hope not in a government, not in a vaccine, not in a hope that this virus won't touch us. Our hope can be on a person who has always been and who always will be, a hope whose personal name is Jesus Christ. And he comes in Jeremiah chapter 29, beginning at verses 4, it says, "This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all of those." Notice this passage right here. It says that I carried into exile from Jerusalem. I want to tell you, I want to remind you, the first point this morning, that what shocks us never shocks God. What shocks us never surprises God. I've said this many times, and I want to remind you right now that this has literally knocked us off of our feet. It's knocked the breath out of us. We don't know what to do. Our government leaders, who are supposed to know what to do, who are supposed to know how to take care of us, don't know what to do and what steps to take. We are certainly in navigating in the unknown, but can I promise you this, that God is already in the unknown. God is in the is the God of tomorrow. He's already in tomorrow. He's already in next week. He's already a month from now. And regardless of how long this takes us to get through, he says, I am carrying this. I am carrying you through this. Now, I know in Jeremiah chapter 29, it looks like the people of Israel, that they were under discipline. They were being, they had disobeyed God. And I don't know, but I'm going to tell you what I know about coronavirus and how it's affecting the world is that this is God trying to tell the entire world, I am in control. If I choose, I can let it affect every person. I can let it affect every nation. I can let it affect every tongue. But can I tell you, the same way that God can step up and speak peace and be still to the coronavirus, and he has so much power and so much authority at his spoken word that the coronavirus has to stop in its tracks. Not another person will be infected. So don't be a hopeless people. Be a people of hope. Be a people that turn their eyes to God. Don't run from God. We are in this because he has chosen to put us in the middle of this. And today his word is, don't be hopeless. Be a people of hope because I am hope. Turn your attention to me. What you're going through, what shocks us, never surprises God. What you're going through is causing you to be hopeless. Can I tell you what I believe that the Holy Spirit is saying even in this moment, is what you're going through that is causing you to be hopeless. It's a part of my plan. I know what I'm doing. I'm orchestrating all the bad things, all the good. I'm orchestrating everything together because I have a plan and a purpose that every person would hear about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And I'm telling you that the corona is not setting the church up for failure because we're not able to meet personally. No, we are being set up by the God, by our Savior, for a victory, to put a black eye on the enemy, to show the people that we're hopeless that there is hope, to show the people that they're living in darkness that there is a light, that there is a calm in the midst of chaos, that there is a people that are not shaking in fear, but there are people that are strong and are hopeful today because of Jesus Christ. It may have caught you by surprise. What you're going through may have caught you by surprise. You were under attack before corona ever hit. You were under attack before this ever hit. You were underwater. You were bobbing up and down before this ever hit. You were feeling depressed before you ever had to stay inside and not see the light of day, it feels like. But I'm telling you that it may have caught you by surprise, but it has not caught your God by surprise. This plan has to do with your future. Where I'm taking you, he says, where I'm taking you is for your well-being. Where I'm taking you is going to be for your welfare. Where I'm taking you for in this moment, it's going to be better for you. I'm doing something in you as you go through this. You see, when we look at this passage of scripture, I want you to understand, and that verse 4 is powerful because the Lord looks at his people and he says, I in the exile that I have taken you into, church, we are being taken into this today. If you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior, it's not by happenstance that you're hearing this message right now. God is trying to look at you and is saying, I have you, I've created you, I watched over you in your mother's womb, and I've got a plan for your life. It's a plan for salvation first and foremost, and then I can change your life if you'll just give me an opportunity. In verse 4, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all of those that I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. He says to build houses and settle down, plant gardens and eat what they produce, marry and have sons and daughters, find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. He says, increase there. Do not decrease. Also seek the peace and the prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. He says it again. He reminds them again. If you missed it the first time, he's telling you again, I've carried you into exile. I've carried you into the unknown. Pray to the Lord for it, for the city, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and the diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams that you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. I have not sent them. The second point this morning that we want to talk to you about is sometimes God needs to take us through something to get us to somewhere. Sometimes God is going to have to take us through some things to get us to the place that he has for us. So Jeremiah 29 poses two problems for the people of God. They were under divine discipline here. They were under divine discipline. They had rebelled and they were and he was punishing them. Do you know it's never being fun? It was never fun for me when I had disobeyed my parents, my dad specifically. And I'll never forget my mom looking at me and saying, just wait till your dad gets home. That was the worst words you ever wanted to hear. In fact, there was a couple of times that me and my brothers had disobeyed my mom, and we went and put on a couple of extra pairs of jeans, and only when Dad come in, he could notice the big bulkiness in our legs, and he said, what's going on? And we told him we were so afraid to get a spanking, and he said, oh, it's not going to happen right now. Go ahead and take your jeans off. And he was right. It didn't happen at that moment, but it happened later. He won it. He knew what he was going to do. You see, it's never being fun. It's never fun being disciplined. And when my dad would sit there and he would pull out his belt and he wouldn't spare the rod, but he wouldn't certainly spoil the child, and he would look at it and he said, this hurts me more than it hurts you. I have never believed that statement and I don't believe it now. But I'm sure it did. Because God never intended for them to go through that, but they did. You see, in verse 4, when the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, he says, build houses and settle down, plant gardens and eat what they produce, marry and have sons and daughters, find wives for your sons, and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Basically, what he's looking at them and is saying, don't stop being the people of God. What do I do while I wait? What do I do while I wait? And there's darkness all around me. God has seemingly turned out the lights of my situation. I'm praying and I'm not hearing. I'm reading and I'm not seeing. What do I do while I wait to hear what God is trying to tell me to do? What do I wait in the darkness? What do I do while I wait in the situations that no one can offer me counsel? He says, don't stop being the people of God. Don't sit back and gripe about your situation. He would look at him and says, stop fussing, stop cussing, stop complaining about where you are in life. Stop blaming other folks for the situation that you put yourself in. When God says that I have sent you into exile, because can I tell you that in this, God is using the folks causing your mess to put you into position to show you his plan. Stop blaming everyone else about maybe where you're at. And this is not just about the coronavirus, but this could be the situation that you have found yourself in. Stop blaming everyone else and start seeking God and say, God, why am I in this mess? I'm telling you that you have a God that loves you so much that he's willing to tell you if this is discipline. He's willing to tell you if it's a trial. Because he has your best interest at heart every day of the time. Why are you waiting? In verse 7, he tells them, he says, also seek the peace and the prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. He says, while you're waiting on the plan for your well-being, he says, seek the well-being of others. What do I do while I wait? He says, while you're waiting on your blessing, be a blessing. While you're waiting on your deliverance, be an aid in someone else's deliverance. While you're waiting on a change to come, be an agent of change in someone else's change. Don't be so self-absorbed while you're waiting, but use it as a ministry to others while you wait for God to minister to you. Can you see what God is trying to set us up for? He's trying to tell us, don't sit back. This is not a time to be quiet. This is not a time to sit in the mully grubs. This is a time to call upon the name of the Lord, and don't stop being the church. Don't stop being the church, because the church is not a building. The church is me and you. And he looks at me and you and says, don't stop being a powerful man of God. Don't stop being a powerful woman of God. Don't stop being a powerful youth of God. Don't stop being a powerful child of God. You have the voice of life inside of you. You have the voice of the ability to call upon the name of the Lord. You have the ability to be an agent of change in this moment. We have the ability to be the people of God. He looks at him and says, seek the peace and the prosperity of the city to which I have carried you in exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Do you hear what he's saying? He's looking at me and you and he's saying, hey, he says, sometimes cities are shutting down. He says, pray for your city. Pray for your mayor. Pray for the county mayor. Pray for your church leaders. Pray for the government leaders. Pray for the police officers. Pray for the firefighters. Pray for the healthcare workers. Pray for the peace of the city. Pray for the prosperity of this city. More importantly, he's telling you, I am setting up Cleveland, Tennessee right now. And if you're watching from another city, he is speaking your city's name and he's saying, I'm setting you up, because when this is over, there's going to be people that were hopeless that are looking for a place of hope. When this is over, I believe that we're going to see an opportunity for one of the greatest revivals to come to the church. I'm not talking about a 9/11 revival. I believe God is getting the attention of the world and is setting the church up to speak hope and be peace and be peace speakers in the same way. We're being set up to pray and to seek God's face while we're here. While we're waiting for change to come, be the agent of someone else's change. But as long at this point, they were getting sermons and they were getting things, not only were they under divine discipline, but they were a long way from home. What was domestic is now foreign. What was comfortable is now miserable. Does it sound familiar? Just a few weeks ago, just last week, I was enjoying time with my family on spring break. Just last week, there was not a cloud in the sky. Just last week, there was no rain in the forecast. Just last week, everything was going along just fine. Just last week, everything was, but now I'm in an uncomfortable situation. Now what was comfortable is now miserable, and what was foreign is what was domestic, what I was used to, is now foreign. Babylon was a foreign place. It was an unknown place. And not only that, they were a long way from home. They were all alone, and they were not only under a discipline, but they were in a despised place. They were now under the attention, they were now under the direction of people that had opposed them and had defeated them. They were in exile to the enemy. But can I tell you, not only were they a long way home, but hopelessness. Not only that, were they under divine discipline. Not only that, were they in a foreign place, but they were also receiving discipline. They were also being reinforced by false prophets. They had people that were standing up, that were saying things. In verse 8, it begins to say, yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and the diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams that you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. Can I tell you that we must be careful what we declare? We better have a good inflow before we start letting there be an outflow of our mouth and our words on Facebook. We better begin to check ourselves, because can I tell you that we can be agents of change and positive change, but we can also be agents of the world, of bickering church, of a church that's not together. We can be people that are sitting there spewing out misery and spewing out hopelessness. But if you are a child of God, there is no reason to let that come out of our mouth. in the midst of this, notice what was happening. He was saying, do not let the prophets and the diviners among you, they had gotten to such a state of hopelessness that they were looking for hope in any direction. They were looking for hope anywhere they could. In fact, in Jeremiah chapter 28, there was a prophet named Hananiah that sat there, and he began to speak, and he began to look, and he comes to Jeremiah. He says, hey, in 2 years, Nebuchadnezzar, the yoke of Nebuchadnezzar, the yoke of Babylon, it's going to be destroyed. And Jeremiah comes up to him and says, Hananiah, he says, don't you know that every prophet before you and every person that's come before you has prophesied of war, has prophesied of a plague, much like we're in. He's prophesied of those things, and it came to pass. But if you come here and you say that God is going to bring us and deliver us, then you will be lifted up among them. He says, but if you're not right, God's going to take care of you. And what does Hananiah do? This prophet, this supposed man of God, trying to infuse hope, begins to take the yoke that Jeremiah was walking around with, and he breaks that wooden yoke, and God comes to Jeremiah, the true man of God, who had a good inflow, who wasn't so concerned about the outflow of his life, but had a good inflow privately, that it flowed publicly when it was necessary. Because it was a good inflow, he had a conversation with God, and God said, Hananiah may have gone, and he may have torn apart and broken this wooden yoke, but I'm replacing it with a yoke of iron that can't be destroyed. And tell Hananiah, by the time this year is over, he'll be dead. The Bible tells us in the last part of Jeremiah 28, it says that he goes to Hananiah and he tells him that he is wrong. He tells him he's a false prophet, and he tells him that he's going to die by the seventh month. Hananiah had died. And we know in Jeremiah 29 that they went into exile. You see, religion wasn't giving them what they thought they should be receiving. If you have been going to a church, if you've been coming to Peerless Road Church, and it's been a head knowledge and not a heart knowledge, this is hitting you, this situation is hitting you to your core right now. But can I tell you, you can call upon the name of the Lord. Religion is not going to save this world. Religion is not going to be what saves the church. Religion is not going to stay. It is not going to stop coronavirus in its track. No, it is going to be the saving grace of Jesus Christ. It will be you and I falling on our knees and saying, God, if I need to repent, God, I'm going to put myself out of it. I'm just going to go ahead and say, God, I repent. I'm going to put myself in the place that David said, and God, I repent for the secret sins that I didn't know I committed against you. I repent if I've not been the person I'm supposed to be. I repent for not being the man of God. I repent for not being the woman of God. I want to be an agent of change in my time, in my generation, in this time of my life. I want to be an agent of change. And so God, forgive me. And we know from Isaiah 6 that an angel of the Lord when Isaiah repented, took a scepter and cleaned his lips, and God called him. Can I tell you, God is calling you and I. When we repent, when we turn from our wicked ways, he will heal our land, but only when we repent and we turn from our wicked ways. But notice what's happening here. They were getting sermons and information that wasn't true. Don't pay attention to the promises that your problems will be fixed if you send in an offering. Don't pay attention to the promises that your problem will be fixed tomorrow, because it's false hope. It's fake news. It's not real. And God looks at Jeremiah and he says, tell the people, they're making me look bad. There better be a good inflow, and they're making me look bad, because religion, well, here I am in a hopeless situation, and I can't even go to church to get hope. It's easy to preach that if you come to God, everything's going to be okay. They felt stuck. They were discouraged. They were broken down. They were bent down. They were broken. The world and hopelessness, it literally will suck the life out of you. It was a bad chapter in a bad book. It was a bad year in a bad life. They were getting sermons with no hope. And all of a sudden, in Jeremiah verse 10, can I tell you, God is using folks that are causing your mess to put you in the position to show you his plan. Remember what we said a while ago. God had carried them into exile. God had carried them into a foreign land. God had carried them into an unknown future. God had carried them into the unknown. God had carried them into the, and maybe into areas where they felt like they weren't going to make it, where they weren't going to do. God carried them. And look at verse 10. And this is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. It's a plan to prosper you and to give you hope and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart, and I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. He is trying to get them to remember, I carried you into it, and I'll bring you out of it. I am the Alpha and I am the Omega. I'm the beginning and I am the end. He's the beginning of your situation. He's the beginning of your darkness. He's the beginning of the things that you feel are hopelessness. He brought you into it. But can I tell you, you're not walking alone. You're not stumbling your way through it. You're not falling your way through it. You may fall flat on your face, but there's a God who's able to pick you up, and he carries you. That's why we can say, when those that wait upon the Lord, he shall renew your strength. Those that wait upon the Lord, those who are in the middle of something, but they're waiting on him. Those who are waiting on him in the middle of a situation that looks dire and looks hopeless, but I'm still going to wait on the Lord, because my hope, I have a hope that my Redeemer is Jesus Christ, and the enemy may knock me down, but he'll redeem my days. He'll redeem my life. He'll redeem the breath in my lungs. He'll redeem what the locust and the cankerworm have tried to destroy. My God is my God, and he's my personal God, and I will wait upon him. And as I wait upon him, he will give me strength. He'll give me strength to continue running and not grow weary. He'll give me strength to walk and not faint. Regardless of where you find yourself at in life, God is carrying us through this. And even more so, while God is carrying us through this, man, I love carrying Bennett. I love when I pick him up and when I get him to sleep and he puts his head right here on my shoulder and I'm able to just speak into his ear. Can I tell you that in the middle of this darkness, in the middle where it feels like God has turned out the lights, when it feels like there's no hope anymore, God is holding you to his chest. Let him speak to you. Would you hear the word that he's saying to you? I know what I'm doing. Would you hear the word of God today? I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to you to bring you back to this place. He's saying, not only am I going to bring you back, but I'm going to bring you, you're an overcomer. The word declares that there's a comeback that is set up for your life. We may be down right now, but there's a comeback that's already planned. There's a comeback date for you to come back and be with me in Peerless Road Church. There's already been a date established, ordained in heaven, that the Savior, the Redeemer of the world, is going to come back and redeem his children. That's why I have hope today. And his promise, can we speak in this time where you have unprecedented, uncharted waters, he wants to speak to you. He says, I will come to you, fulfill my good promise. And he looks at it and says, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. This plan that feels hopeless, this plan that feels lonely, this plan that feels dark, this plan that is uncertain, he looks at you and says, I know the plan that I have worked out for you. It's a plan to prosper you and not to harm you. Hear the promise of God this morning. It is a plan to give you hope and a future. And you will call on me and come and pray and seek me with all of your heart. In spite of hopelessness, the last point that I want to share with you this morning is, in spite of hopelessness, God can turn your yesterdays into a better tomorrow. Do you hear me this morning? Regardless of what yesterday looks like, regardless of how bad today may look in comparison to tomorrow, He looks and he offers you a promise, and it's this, that I'm going to turn your yesterday into a better tomorrow. God is so good at what he does that he can take our yesterdays and turn them into better tomorrows. If we can endure through the night, joy is going to come in the morning. Joy is not that I get to go out. Joy is not based on happiness. Happiness is based on how I feel. But joy is that innate ability. It's something on the inside that says, that joy is in the gospel, that God is in complete control, that God is in complete, that when I look at his track record, I identify he can be depended on. He looks at you. He says, then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. I love verse 13. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart, and I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations. I want to just stop right there. You will call upon me and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all of your heart. My God is not playing hide and go seek when he turns out the lights. I used to love playing hide and go seek in the dark. We used to love it. We would play it around our home, and we would just go play hide and go seek. And it was fun to see somebody dash out. But can I tell you, God is not playing hide and go seek right now. God is in the middle of the coronavirus. God is in the middle of creation. God is in the grocery stores. God is on the Facebook and Instagram and Twitter and everything else you're following because you have nothing else to do. God is right there amongst your children, your spouse, and your friends when you call upon them and you check on them. God is not playing hide and go seek right now. He is firmly seated on the throne of heaven and is saying, if you'll seek me and find me, if you seek me, you shall find me when you search for me with all of your heart. Not just a good night prayer, not just a good morning prayer, not just a prayer that just to feel like you're knocking it off the docket, but a prayer that says, God, I'm coming down to your altar and I'm asking you to speak to me, God. Give me hope. Give me hope for the people that I'm going to speak to today. Give me hope that I can put on Facebook. Give me hope that I can put on social media. God, give me a word. Give me a fresh word. Give me a rhema word. Give me a word that's like the manna from heaven that fell down to your children. It was fresh and it was only for that day. God, give me a personal word that I can speak, that I can hold on to, that'll get me through exile, that'll get me through this unknown, that'll get me through this dark time, that'll get me through my trial, because Lord, you're taking me in something to get me to somewhere. And so, Father, the promise of God this morning is not only does he have a plan in your situation, not only does he have a plan in the dark situation, not only does he have a plan where you're at right now, but he looks and says, if you want to know what my plan is for the future, if you'll seek me with all of your heart, I shall be found by you. And I will speak to you the promises of what's coming forward. You see, for us as a church, as we get ready to close this morning, I want you to understand that you can trust the track record of God. You can trust his track record. There have been many before you that were in the same hopeless situation that you are. And he says, if you'll check my track record, you'll see that I have a good track record. And you'll see that I have a plan for you. He says, I not only have a plan, I love this. God is able to look at you. He says, not only do I have the plan, I know the plan. I know what I'm doing. I know how this piece, if you turn it ever so slightly, will fit in that space that you've been trying to work it together. You've been trying to do it on your own, but I know the plan. And it's a plan to give you hope and a future and speak to you today. If you will just simply call upon the name of the Lord and say, God, I repent. I repent. Forgive me, Father, for the sins that are in my life. Forgive me for everything that I've done. Forgive me for not being a person of faith. Forgive me for not being a person of hope. Forgive me for not being that person. And God, come into my life and forgive you. And forgive me, God will forgive you because Jesus loves you just the way you are. But he refuses to leave you where you're at. And right now, God is touching you. So right now in this moment, as you see, we're getting ready to close in just a few moments. Those of you on this altar that's standing in front of me are pictures of prodigals. of pictures and prayer requests of our church that normally meets here every week. And every week we have made it a point to pray over this altar and to pray over our prodigals and pray over those who don't have faith and pray over the hopeless. Pray over those who feel like there's no hope in their life. Today I'm going to kneel and we're going to pray over this altar. We're going to continue to pray because I'm telling you, God is setting us up for victory. We're going to see a victory in coronavirus. We're going to see a victory in the church. We're going to see a revival that's been unprecedented. We're going to see a revival that's going to catch the world by storm and governments by storm. And the enemy feels like he's winning, but he's already being set up for a black eye. Would you pray with me right now over this altar as we get ready to close? Father, God, I thank you. Lord, I thank you that on this altar, there were people, Lord, there were parents and grandparents. There were spouses, Father God. There are spouses and there are children, there are parents, Father God, who feel like they're in a hopeless situation. They feel like there's no hope. They feel like there's nothing going right. They've prayed and they've fasted, Father. They've been asking you for several years, God, for you to do something. And it feels like, Lord, that it's never going to happen. But would you remind us of your word in verse 10? You said after 70 years were completed that you were bringing them to this place. Father, you know just how long we're going to be in this situation. You know just how long the coronavirus is going to be here in the United States and in Cleveland. But Father, we declare, Lord, that we're not going to quit being a people of hope. We're not going to quit being agents of change. We're not going to quit being this. But we ask you right now that you would touch our prodigals. Lord, use this situation. Use those who are lost in sin. Use this, God, this coronavirus, Lord, around the world, Lord, to show the people that you are God. Bring us to our knees. Bring us to our knees. Because, Father, our hope is not built on a stock market. Our hope is not built on a government, but it's built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And, Father, do whatever you could need to do, Lord, to bring people to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. We, your people, are not concerned. We are not fearful. We are not a people, Lord, are shaking in our knees, but we are prepared to stand up and to be the voice of life in the middle of death. We are the people that are ready. So God, bring whatever it takes, Lord. Do whatever it takes to bring your lost to saving grace of Jesus Christ. We are ready for you, Lord. And Lord, I pray over the people of God. I pray over the people of God right now. Lord, if it feels like we're not ready. It feels like we're not ready for what's happening. It feels like we're not ready, Lord, for what you're doing. It feels like we're not ready, Lord, that we're so worried about what we've set up in our life. It feels like, Lord, we're not ready, Lord, for what's coming. But Lord, remind us. Lord, open up your word today, God, and show us what the book of Acts church looked like. Lord, that we all came together, Lord, and that may be what you bring us to. But Lord, would you soothe our souls? Would you speak into our spirit through the Holy Spirit? God, do something in us that prepares us for what lies ahead. And Lord, as we are prepared, we will not be shaken, but we will walk in confidence. We will walk in understanding that you are the God who opens up the Red Sea. You are the one who opens up seas to walk on dry ground. You're the one who lets clothes not falter. You're the one who doesn't let us buy shoes because they don't wear out. You are the God who provides manna, God, and you are the one whose eyes are on the sparrow. God, prepare us, your people. Calm our fears with the word of the Spirit of the living God. Right now, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad that you've been able to join us for a personal encounter with Jesus Christ today. I pray that you will go back and watch whatever part of this day this sermon spoke to you, because I believe it's a living word. And go and share it with somebody. Blast it all over social media. Whatever God spoke to your life, whatever he's speaking into your life, whatever comes on the inflow, be prepared to put it on the outflow. But remember, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my God and my Redeemer. So watch what you say. Be encouraged. Pick up the phone and call somebody that you know. Maybe pick up the phone and call somebody that may not have family. We have many that are singles. We have many that are widows and different ones. And while our team is here for you, we want you to be the church. Be the church. Be the men and women of God that are looking out for each other. Ephesians tells us, or Galatians chapter 6 tells us, to bear you one another's burdens. So if we have a person in need today, go and be the church. Be the church. Be the vessel of God's power and anointing and hope in today. Don't forget to go online as we continue. There'll be new things that are going every day. There'll be devotions and different things. Pastor Kathy, like I said, Pastor Josh and Angela, Pastor Angela are doing so many great things. You're going to hear from different voices in Peerless Road Church. You're going to hear from my voice as well, but you're going to hear of different voices of hope in the middle of this exile that we feel that we're in. Remember, God's carried us in it. God's going to see us through it, and we're going to come out of it, and we're going to come out of it better than we were before because he knows what he's doing. God bless you today. Spend time with your family, but spend time with God as well. We love you. Have a great day.